The cross was before me. The world behind me. The cross before me. The world behind me. The cross was before me.
Hallelujah. You know, a lot has happened. A lot is happening for you to hear, saints. And agape. You know, when I was singing jazz, I had a band. The last band that we had together in Madison was called Love's Fire. Love's Fire. Ain't that something? And yet God knew I did not really know what love was all about. Amen?
Amen.
So you can sit it up a little bit so I can see. Yeah. Yeah. I didn't really know what love was all about. I thought I did. But when God showed me the fire of his love, how many know that his love is a consuming fire?
Amen.
It burned away everything.
Amen.
But you know, God blesses us with gifts and talents and abilities. I made the decision through the help of the Holy Spirit and through the saints of God who prayed me through, through my mother. And when I think about, amen, that 33 years ago, that God birthed in the city of Milwaukee, Agape Love Deliverance Church. And at the time in that little raggedy church, we praise God, we worship God in that church. And don't forget, you have a word some, you know, on next week. Yes, man. Being with us, the Lord is beside me and Sarah. But we went through a lot. But as I prayed in the middle of the night, you know how sometimes, because I always ask God what I should, never assuming what God's people need to hear. Right. And God spoke to me. He said, no turning back. Now, let me be honest. Pastor, there are times that I did it. You know, Pastor Virginia, there are times that I said, well, not, Lord, is this you really? You know, because when you have those ups and downs, those in and outs, those situations that, especially unexpected, you really wonder, Lord, is this really you? Because the Bible said, as many as live, what? Righteously, is going to go through some things. But when we go through it, sometimes we don't even remember that. If you live righteous, you're going to have some afflictions.
All right.
If you live righteous, you're going to go through some ups and downs. Yeah. The enemy will target you. The enemy will come against you. He'll come against your mind. He'll come against your finances. Sometimes it's your body. Sometimes it's your family. Sometimes it's relationships. Sometimes, whatever it is, but remember this, no turning back. Come on and say it with me, no turning back.
No turning back.
And so, yeah, did the enemy try to tempt me to go back to singing jazz? Oh, many times. Amen. But every time I had a dream about me trying to sing jazz or being in some club in my visions, I told y'all they gave me the mic in one club. I thought for sure I was going to backslide that time. I had a little vision, and somebody said, you want something to drink? And I had my little ginger ale or something like that in the glass. And I had already said to the Lord, I'm done with this. I can't deal with this. It's too much. I'm going back to the world. I'm going back to jazz. I'm going back to the money. Going back to my friends. So I had a vision. Amen. And so God gave me, he allowed me to have a little vision. Here I am sitting in this nightclub. Amen. I had my little glass right there. And I knew what nothing in it but soda, because even when I say jazz, I couldn't drink and sing because it messes with your throat. Yeah. So I'm sitting there in the nightclub, and somebody gives me a mic. And when they gave me the mic, you know what came out? Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Right. Yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. And they told me, you need to get out of here and go back to church. I knew God was saying, no turning back.
No turning back.
Amen. When God makes up his mind about you, you can't change it. I'm going to say it again. When God makes up his mind about you, you can't change God's mind. Because guess what? You can't change God's will when it comes to you. And you're a chosen vessel. Everyone that's here. And Agape, I welcome you. Thank God for all of you, our saints and friends, our Agape alumni all over the country, our Agape Love members that are home watching and streaming. And saints, I love y'all. And I know you're helping me to celebrate 33 years. Amen.
Amen.
Next week, October 16th, we'll be here Saturday.
Amen.
2:30, we're going to start. We have a great preacher. And amen. And I'm telling you, his wife can blow. Amen.
Amen.
So be with us. And then Sunday, we're going to wrap it up at 1 o'clock.
Amen.
4716 West.
Hallelujah.
Amen. I want to get that out because sometimes we had problems with our Facebook page, y'all. There were some technical issues, so we just want to let you know. Yes, the Bible College is still operating. Yes, amen, we're still here. And yes, God is still in control. Amen. All right, let's go to the book of St. Luke, amen, the 5th chapter. And as God ministered to me, because when we get to this point in time in the season of our ministry, I always seek God concerning, is there anything that he wants me to stop doing or add? And we will be ordaining, amen, Dr. Sarah Knox, she will be amen, being ordained as a pastor here. And a doctor, y'all know Sarah Billy. She actually been helping me pastor all these years, amen, anyway. Hallelujah, but I tell you, she has, Sarah can preach. Now, I'm a teacher, but Sarah can preach, amen. And so, you know, we will be hearing from her every month to preach the word of God. And we have some ministers that are being ordained, Mr. Shelley, amen, Mr. Amen. Vanessa, amen, our deacon, amen, Jeffrey Barnes. So we got, amen, we got some great things that are rolling. Amen. We just thank God for all of those that are here. Amen. We just give praise to God for all of y'all, everything that y'all do. Yes. So our ordination will be taking place as well. You know, God is so good. Amen. And yes, Pastor, I forgot about you. You keep your evangelist license. Amen. That's right. That's right. Amen. Hallelujah. God is good. Is that right, y'all? Somebody say hallelujah. Somebody shout glory to God. St. Luke, the 5th chapter. Let's start there. And it came to pass that as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret. And he saw two ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. And if you want to, please stand. Amen. We're just going to read down to the 7th verse. And he entered into one of the ships, amen, which was Simon's. And he prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land. And he sat down and he taught the people out of the ship. And now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a draw or a catch. Simon answered and said unto him, Master, we've toiled all night and we've taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. And when they had done this, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes. And their net brake. And they beckoned unto their partners, which were in the other ship, that they should come and help them. And they came, and they filled both the ships, so that it began to sink. You may have your seats.
Amen.
So here, we see here, let's set this up. The Lord Jesus Christ was getting ready to, amen, bring in his disciples that would be part of the kingdom purpose and plan of God, that the gospel will be carried out throughout the land. And so being led by the Holy Spirit, as always, he's gone to a very familiar lake, Gennesaret, and he sees the fishermen fishing. And let me just say this, God always calls busy people.
Yeah.
So if you're busy, you know, because God knows that you have a discipline, that you have an ability, and that there's something that you might want to do, amen, for him. But sometimes God's got to flip it. So nevertheless, he goes to these seasoned, and remember, not only were they fishermen, but they were seasoned fishermen.
All right.
And so he's asking Simon to push out. Now, think about Peter and James and John, these fishermen. They're probably wondering, no, what does he know about fishing? He's in the temple preaching. What did he know about being a fisherman? And yet, God called him and told him to tell Simon and them, go fishing. Mm-hmm. And Peter and them said, well, we toiled all night. So what does he say? We toiled all night, Lord. If there was any fish to be caught, we would have caught at least one, amen, whitehead or a bluegill or one of the fishes in the Lake Michigan. Kind of fish
cod?
We got? Yeah, I think we have cod, I'm not sure. Crappies, yes. We would have caught something, a crappie or something. And yet, Jesus said, well, just going back out there anyway. Amen. I know we got salmon, I believe we have salmon too. So they feel like they might know a little bit more about fishing than Jesus did, but Jesus said, nevertheless, go back out. And when they obeyed God, when they obeyed Christ Jesus, amen, they took in such a multiple of fishes that even their net break.
Yeah.
That 8th verse said, when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at his knees, to Jesus' knees, saying, depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. For he was astonished that maybe the Lord might know better about you, your business than you know. That maybe God may know a little bit more about your marriage than you know. God may know a little bit more about your ministry than you know. God may know a little bit more about your future than you know. See, we forget that God is omniscient.
Yes.
He's all-knowing, all-wise, all-powerful. He know more about you than you do.
Yes.
So he was astonished at all that were with him. Amen. At the draught of fishes which they had taken. And so was also James and John, the sons of Zebedee, which were partners with Simon. And Jesus said unto them, Simon, fear not. From thenceforth thou shalt catch men.
Yeah.
So the fishermen have the skill. They have some of the discipline, but they're going to get even deeper discipline now. Because they're going to be taught, amen, how to disciple. How not just to catch men, but how to disciple. And when they had brought their ships to land, they forsook all and they did what? Follow. Say it with me. They forsook all and they what?
Follow him.
Amen. No turning back.
Turn it back.
Amen. Now, sometimes it's easy to go with Jesus for a while. But there's something that happened along the way. As Jesus was training them and discipling them and teaching them and showing them how to forgive and how to love. Amen. Let's go over here to this one particular scripture that really blesses me because sometimes when God is calling you, amen, there might be some things that you theologically you might have to correct.
All right.
Amen. Because remember, they were born, they were Jewish. Amen. They were children of Israel. And they had a certain style of teaching and learning about how to minister to people. Well, Jesus, if you go with me to Matthew, the fourth chapter, we're going to see, amen, that Jesus did teach them again about what they were supposed to do. Now, go with me. And they followed Jesus. And the 22nd verse, Matthew 4 and 22nd. And they immediately, they left the ship and their father and followed him. They left their ship and their what? Father. So sometimes when God calls you out, sometimes you got to even leave your family. I'm not saying leave. All right, now listen, there ain't no.
Come on.
Let's make it plain. God had a plan and a purpose for those men to leave their family so that they could be used for, amen, the kingdom. God was going to make sure that the family was taken care of. But sometimes it costs you something. Is that right?
Yes.
That's right, though. That's right, little Norman. It costs him the price to pay.
Yes.
Amen. Sometimes your family, and sometimes, it's one thing for you to leave your family, but another thing is when your family leaves you. Amen. When your family leaves you. Because there's a price to pay when you follow Jesus. Amen. I wanted to make sure y'all saw that. And Jesus went about all of Galilee. He started his ministry, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, healing all manner of sickness, all manner of disease among the people. And his fame went throughout all Syria. They brought unto him all kinds of sick people that were taken with divers diseases, torments, and those which were possessed with devils, and those who were lunatic, and amen, those that had the palsy, and he healed them. And there followed him great multitudes of people from Galilee, from Decapolis, and the city, that's a 10 city area, and from Jerusalem, and from Judea, and from beyond Jordan. So his ministry grew, amen. So in 3.5 years, his ministry just multiplied, thousands of people. So yeah, he needed an inner circle. He needed some men that would work with him, not against him. Not he trying to push and they trying to pull. Amen. Yes. But they were operating, amen, according to the will, plan, and purposes that God had called them. They were all unique. They all had different personalities.
Yes.
Peter was the one that had a big mouth. Amen. Peter was the one that was quick-tempered. He would cut your ear off. Amen. He cut the high priest's servant's ear off at the Garden of Gethsemane.
Yeah.
John was the one that beloved John. And the sons of thunder, when Jesus went to Capernaum and they didn't receive the gospel, amen, the sons of thunder said, Lord, let's just call down fire from heaven.
Yeah.
Let's burn them all up. And Jesus had to correct their theology and say, you don't know what manner of teaching is.
Right.
We ain't doing that no more. We know Elijah called down fire.
Hallelujah.
This is a whole different ministry.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
So don't you try to be nobody but who you are.
All right.
Amen. Because God had 12. Jesus called 12 and they all had a unique. Judas was a treasure. He liked money.
Yeah.
But we know he had some issues. Amen. He wasn't really faithful to the Lord. Your loyalty, your faithfulness will be tested. Your character will be tested. Even your commitment to Christ will be tested. Amen. There's a lot of things that I've been tested with these 33 years. Many things. Many decisions based on my relationship with the Lord. Many opportunities that could have went another way. Many opportunities to get money a different way. But yet God said, I am Jehovah Jireh. I'm going to take care of you. I'm the Lord your shepherd, and you shall not want. Amen. So men have their plans, but I want you, amen, we're going back to the gospel, but I want you to run over to Proverbs 16, 1 and 4, and then Proverbs 19 and 21. Amen. Proverbs, let's go to 16. When you're there, say, I am there.
I am there.
And then we're going to come back to, amen, the new covenant. But I want to get you, because I want, and those who are listening, I hope you have your yellow marker. Make sure that you write this down, because we're living in a time where there is a great shifting. Mm-hmm. The Spirit of God is moving in the land.
Yes.
Amen. And the time, because the Lord is on his way back.
Amen.
Those of you who are in the fivefold ministry, mm-hmm. amen, God is, there is going to be a shift in your ministry. Amen. And your family, amen, your business, your finances, all of it, amen. God, I really believe this. I believe this is a prophetic word.
Yes.
Expect increase.
Increase.
Blessing.
Hallelujah.
Somebody say increase. Blessing.
Blessing.
I shall abound.
I shall abound.
To every good work.
Every good
because
work.
You don't need finances to back up what God is about to give you to do.
All right.
Amen.
All right.
Expect an unexpected things to happen. Amen. The preparations of the heart of man. Proverbs 16 and 1. There is a preparation of the heart in man, but the answer of the tongue is from the Lord. So men, many, there's a lot of times the things that I plan to do during these 33 years. But God only permitted me to do certain things. And the thing that God plans for you is the thing that God, amen, will watch over and perform in your life. He is not responsible for something we come up. Because, I mean, you know, in 33 years, I came up with a lot of plans, you know, but God had his plan. So look what it said. But the answer in the from the tongue is from the Lord.
From the Lord.
For all the ways of man are clean in his own eyes, but it's the Lord who weighs the spirits.
Yes.
Amen. Our motives. Is there any hidden agenda in me?
Right.
Is there any ulterior motives for me to do what I'm doing?
Right.
Do I really love the Lord all of my heart, with all of my mind, and all of my strength?
All right.
Amen. And my neighbor
yes.
as myself. Amen. Why are we serving the Lord today? Why? How in the world can God call somebody that had a whole different plan for their life to his plan? And even in the midst of the plan, there are times I said, Lord, is this you? And he keeps pushing you on because there's no turning back. Look at somebody say, because there's no turning back.
There's no turning back.
Amen. Now look what else he says. Commit thy works. So I have to learn to commit everything to the Lord. And you do too. Commit thy works unto the Lord, and thy thoughts shall be established. So when you ask God, what is your will? And the old saints used to say, they wouldn't even give you an answer if you could come over, or they could, or you invite them somewhere. They say, baby, if the Lord will. They are, in all the ways, they would what? Acknowledge him. And he would do what? Direct their path. And so they never said anything. They wouldn't ask you back. And they said, well, you know the Lord will, not necessarily. Maybe the Lord might have a different plan for me today.
Amen.
I might be able to come, but maybe not this week, but maybe next week.
Yeah.
So they would always say, if the Lord will. And we need to go back to doing that. Don't y'all think?
Amen.
I think some of the troubles that we're having
Amen.
In the world and in our communities, because we're not saying enough, if the Lord will.
Amen.
Amen. We need to pray on certain places and corners and in our neighborhoods, in certain communities. And say, Lord, if the Lord will. Because you might want to pray on Burline. The Lord said, no, this time I need you on North Avenue.
Right, right.
So that we can get God's take on it.
Mm-hmm.
Because he knows the areas that need prayer.
Right.
Or the family that need prayer. Mm-hmm. The Lord have made all things for himself. Yes, even the wicked for the day of evil. But everyone that is a proud in their heart and an abomination to the Lord, though they join hand in hand, he shall not be unpunished. So God will deal with the wicked and the evil.
Right.
But as far as he's concerned, he wants you to know his will.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen?
He always wants you to know. Because the 7th verse said, when a man's ways please the Lord, he'll make even your enemies to be at peace.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen?
So the 9th verse said, a man's heart divides his way. But guess what? The Lord will do what? He'll direct your steps.
Yeah.
Trust in the Lord all thine heart. Lean not to thine understanding. God will download it to your spirit and to your heart to do and fulfill his will. And if you do God's will, he's going to make sure it succeeds. So let's go to Proverbs 19 and look at the 21st verse. You want to make sure that the things that God has called you to do will succeed? Because many are the plan. Look what it says here. Amen. Proverbs 21, or Proverbs 19 rather, look at the 21st verse. There are many plans, or many plans in a man's heart. Amen. Devices, plans, means the same thing. In a man's heart. Nevertheless, the counsel of the Lord shall stand. Amen. So many other plans in a man's heart, but it's God's will and counsel that's going to set. In the final analysis, are you in the will of God? Amen. It's always God's will to save. It's always God's will to heal. It's always God's will that you give. Because Jesus already told us, give it and shall be what? Give it back to you in good measure. Pressed down, shaken together, running over. So there's some things that you just know absolutely, unequivocally that God would have you do. Well, let's go back to the old, to the New Testament. And let's see another man that had to make a decision not to leave the Lord. Because we know what happened to Peter. Mm. Amen. Peter said, I'm going fishing after the resurrection, didn't he?
Yeah.
After the death, burial, and resurrection. Mm-hmm. Let's run over there right quick to John, and then we'll go and see what happened to the Apostle Paul. Because I want you to understand that, yes, in life, there are times when you wanna just go back. Go back to what? What did Peter say to Jesus when all the other disciples left him? He said, where can we go?
You have
the words to what?
Eternal life.
Eternal life. And does God have the words to eternal life?
Amen.
So where are you going to go? Where are you going to get a better counselor? Where are you going to get a better healer?
Where?
A better doctor? I always tell my doctor, I got a primary. And his name is J-E-S-U-S. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
He's my doctor, he's my healer, he's my heavy load carrier, he's my burden bearer, he's my CEO about my finances.
Yes.
He helped us to pay this church off two years in advance.
Yes, he did.
Ain't that something?
Yes, he did.
Glory to God. Somebody glory shout glory.
Glory.
And so here is Peter in the 20th. Now remember, he called him, he said, I'm going to make you fishers of men. But in John, let's go to, are you at the 20th verse, 20th chapter? Let's go to the fourth verse. But when the morning was now come, amen. This is the verse I want to hear. Simon Peter saith unto him, I go a fishing. What you doing, Peter? The death, burial, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and he had already revealed himself to them, because for 40 days Jesus walked the earth. But Peter, I guess he want to go back and pick up his business. And so that third verse, y'all there? Amen.
Amen.
All right. Simon Peter saith unto them, I go a fishing. They said unto him, we also go with thee. See, you have the power to influence, but you got to use your influence righteously. What are you talking about? He going fishing. And because God had already determined that Peter would be a leader, but he leading them back the wrong way. So I submit to you, we will answer to God how we influence people. How, and look at whom much is given, much is required. And so then I'm going to be held accountable. Amen. That's right, 21 and 3. Is that it? I'm sorry, 21 and 3. So Simon Peter, he says to them, I'm going fishing. And they said to them, we also go with thee. They went forth and entered into the ship immediately, and that night they caught nothing that night. You know why they didn't catch nothing? They wasn't in God's will.
All right.
See, not when you turn back to the, what do I look like? You know, especially my age now, I'm trying to get a gig in a nightclub, trying to see jazz. Isn't that crazy? I ain't going back. When I was still young, when I first got to start pastoring, I ain't going back to that. Go back to what? Look at your neighbor and say, go back to what?
Go back to what?
Now, do your shoulders like this, like you're going to give me some body language. Just say, go back to what?
Go back to what?
Amen. Amen. I ain't going back. Look what he said. And they said, amen. And when the morning came, or would now come, Jesus stood on the shore. But the disciples knew not that it was Jesus. Then Jesus said unto them, children, have you any meat? They answered him, no. That's about what would happen, too. If you go back, you got money. No. You ain't. Whatever you lost, amen, God has given you. He wants you to stick with him. He's the one that's been paying the bills. He's the one that's been keeping you healthy. He's the one that's been blessing your marriage, blessing your family, blessing your children. Amen. We have to understand that apart from him, we can do nothing. Is that what Jesus said?
Yeah.
Apart from me, you can do nothing. So he said, children have any meat? They said, no. And he said unto them, cast the net on the right side of the ship, and you shall find. Seek, and you shall what? Find. They cast therefore, and now they were not able to draw in for the multitude of fishes. Sound like a rewind. Sound like somebody's trying to remind them. See, we used to sing a song. Sarah used to direct our children's choir. I belong to God.
Right.
From the crown of my head to the soul. See, when let me tell you this. You are sealed. Everybody in this congregation. You are sealed, the hand of God. You have a seal in your forehead. Your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And y'all listening by way of streaming, you are sealed. Now, when you have a seal on you, that means, and this ain't no tattoo seal. This is the seal of God.
Amen.
You are identified as Him, as His. Now, look what it says here. Therefore, the disciples who Jesus loved saith unto Peter. Now, John, he recognized, that's the Lord. It's the Lord. Now, when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he girded his fisher's coat unto him, for he was naked. And that's exactly what we go back. When we go back to the world, it's like we naked. We done took off our robe of righteousness.
All right.
You don't want to be seen naked when the Lord comes.
Amen.
And he did cast himself into the sea. And the other disciples came in a little ship, for they that were not far from them, but as it were 200 cubits, dragging the net with fishes. See, so just like the people were blessed that were with Simon Peter and James and John at the beginning, now these other people are being blessed too. So God, if he has to do it again, and I want you to put your right hand up to God and say, Lord, if I ever think about leaving you, do it again, Lord.
Do it again, Lord.
Come on, tell me again. Do it again, Lord.
Do it again, Lord.
Say it one more time. Do it again, Lord.
Do it again, Lord.
See, I'm in love with him, but if I ever want to quit you, Lord, just move me again. Just remind me of how you healed me back in the day. Just remind me back in 1997, 1998, when we started the Bible Cop. Just remind me how good you were to my daughter and my son. Just remind me, Lord, do it again. Because there ain't no turning back. Now, let's look what this says here. And this blessed me. I sometimes enjoy when God gives me to feed y'all because it comes to me first. So, look what it said. And as soon as they were come to land, they saw a fire. And coals there, and fish laid thereon, and bread. See, the master of heaven and earth, the one that said, peace be still, he had a fish dinner ready.
All right.
Amen. I like cod, and I like haddock, pollock, amen. He had a fish dinner ready. I don't know if he had coleslaw, or I can't eat french fries no more, because ankles be swollen.
From the spot.
I love a good catfish dinner every now and then, amen. With hot sauce. But check it out. Jesus had the fish ready. Amen. He said, bring it. But see, now look, he said, he had fish laid there on and bread. But he all so the Lord had a dinner spread for him. But then he said, yeah, bring some of that other fish too. Because, you know, they had different types of fish.
Right.
Amen. Yeah, in the Lake of Gennesaret. And so here they're bringing the fish and some of them. He said, so he wants you to be included in the blessing, be included in the catch, be included, your ministry included in the harvest, included in the souls. Amen. You know, because he made us priests and kings of our God. You belong to him and he belongs to you. You and him and he and you. Now look what happened. So Simon Peter went up, drew the net to land full of great fishes, 100. Look what it said. And 53 fishes. And for all there were so many, yet not the net was broken.
Wow.
So Jesus said to them, come and dine. Let's have dinner today. I need to talk to you. Every now and then you need to just have a lunch with Jesus.
Right.
A dinner. A great woman of God years ago gave a testimony when she was preaching at Action for Christ. And many of y'all might remember the name Evangelist Claire Strong.
Yeah.
I was there that night. I was a baby saint, so I was just really impressed and thrilled because the woman of God was so anointed and appointed.
Yes, she is.
But she shared a testimony how she wanted just to spend the day with Jesus. And of course, she was a word woman. And so she said that she prepared, she prayed about it and fasted and asked the Lord, will you come and have lunch with me today? And she said, now, I know I can do the communion, but I want you to have lunch with me. And I'm going to prepare something for you. And I don't know if she prepared fish or lamb, but she said that the Lord told her, yes, I'm going to come by and have lunch with you. And she told us, and you may not want to believe it, but I do.
I do.
She said she sat at the table, and she got everything ready. But she said the Lord just said, keep your eyes closed. And he came and had lunch with her. And when he got ready to leave, she saw nothing but light. The Lord had lunch with somebody that wanted a fellowship. When the last time you wanted to just spend time to glory. Because you can eat the word and that's lunch right there. That's dinner right there. Jesus said, I'll give you each day your what? Your daily bread. Now, I never forgot that testimony. And you know, I've heard millions of testimonies since I've been saved. But there's some things that some people testify that go right to your heart. You know why? Because I would love for the Lord to come and spend lunch with me. Hallelujah. Amen. So we welcome him to the wedding feast. Remember? Amen. We welcome him to the weddings. We welcome him. You all welcome the Lord every day to your home. Amen. Hallelujah. Put your hand up and say, Lord, you're welcome anytime. And so look what happened. So Jesus said, come and dine. And none of his disciples dared ask him, who art thou? Knowing that it was the Lord. But he had changed his visions. So they didn't know, he didn't look like what he was, who he was, because he just wanted them to see him by faith. So then Jesus didn't come and take a bread, and he gave the fish likewise. And now it was the third time that Jesus showed himself to his disciples. That's why they should have recognized him when he came.
Right.
After that, he was risen from the dead. So when they had dined, after they had ate good, look what it says. Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, love thou me more than these? He said unto him, Lord Jesus, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He said, feed my babies, feed my lambs. Feed these little ones, these little lambs.
Yes.
Amen. Don't forget about the babies.
Yes.
Feed the lambs. Amen.
Amen.
He said unto him again, the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, do you love me? He said, yeah, Lord, you know that I love you. And Jesus said, feed my sheep. Mm-hmm. Feed the sheep.
Mm-hmm.
Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus said unto him, feed my sheep. And verily, verily, I say unto thee, when thou wast young, thou girdest thyself and walked wherever thou wanted to go. But when thou shalt be old, thou shalt stretch forth thine hands, and another shall gird thee and carry thee where thou would not go. This thing he signified what death he should glorify God. And when he had spoken, he said unto him, but follow me. He gave him the same instructions, Mr. Vanessa, that he gave him when he first called him. Every now and then, God has to remind you, you belong to me, and I belong to you. Follow me. Then Peter, turning about, seeing the disciple whom Jesus loved, which also leaned on his breast at supper, and said, Lord, which is he that betrayeth thee? And Peter seeing him, said to Jesus, Lord, and what shall this man do? And Jesus said, if I will that he tarry till I come. What is that to you? Just follow me.
Yeah.
Get your mind off of whatever everybody else's ministry. You just follow me. Stop worrying about somebody else preach. Follow me. Don't worry about the anointing on somebody else and how they pray and how they say. Follow me. Don't worry about that book that you wrote and then how many copies you sell. Follow me. Follow me in your ministry. Follow me in your home. Follow me in your husband. Stop looking at everybody else's husband. Look at your own husband. Amen. And follow me. Look at the old wife and follow me. She said, we get distracted. Amen. We almost done. Lord Jesus, let me finish this up right quick. Hallelujah. Somebody say, no turning back. Amen. You have to remind Peter, no turning back. Amen. So let's go to 1 Peter 3, 10 and 13. I can't get through all of this, so I'm just going to wrap it up here. Amen. There is a warning in Luke. Let's go there to this warning in Luke, and then we're going to wrap it up. But I want to say this. Because it's 33rd anniversary. 33 is a big, you know, there's something about perfect. God deals with numbers. And it's the perfect, it's a fullness. 30, because 3 is the Trinities, right?
Yes.
It's the perfect fullness. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. And Jesus did 33 years on this planet Earth. 33 and a third. Amen. On this earth. Well, in Luke, amen. What did I tell y'all? 9? Did I tell you 9? Okay. Okay, Luke 9, and let's look at 56, and we'll start reading there. Hallelujah. See, he wanted to warn them about the right attitude. Because when you follow the Lord, you got to follow his spirit, follow his attitude. Now, the James and John, remember I told you they didn't have the right spirit? Look at the 54th verse that we're going to go down. Because they were still operating under the law, but there's going to be a shift now. Now, the 54th verse said, and when his disciples, James and John, saw this, they saw that they did not want to receive the Lord. He said, will thou then command fire to come down from heaven and consume them even as Elijah did? You see how they're still going back? And that's what we have to do. Remember, God is doing a new thing. Look at somebody say, God is doing a new thing. See, we got to get with his plan.
Yes.
They were still thinking Elijah and Moses. Remember, Jesus was going to fulfill the law. So he said, but he turned and rebuked them and said, you don't know what manner of spirit you are. For the Son of Man is not come to destroy men's lives. Amen. But to save them. And they went on to another village. So it's important for us to understand that it's the gospel. Somebody say, it's the gospel.
It's the gospel.
It's the gospel. Say it again, it's the gospel.
It's the gospel.
So let's go. We're going to wrap up. Let's go to Ephesians, the 5th chapter. Amen. And then we're going to, yeah, because I want to make sure that you get all of this. Ephesians, the 5th chapter, and then we're going to close in 1 John. But let's get this, because I want you to understand that when you put your hand to the gospel pile, amen, you look back, you're not worthy. So to be worthy for the kingdom, you got to be faithful. Everybody say faithful.
Faithful.
You got to be loyal.
Loyal.
And righteous.
And righteous.
This is scripture in Proverbs 28:20. Make sure you write this down. And y'all that are listening, write this down. Proverbs 28:20 says, the faithful man shall what?
Abound
with blessings. So if you want to know how to be blessed, Proverbs 28:20 tells you. Just be faithful. The faithful man shall abound with blessings. And be righteous. Amen. Because, amen, God will bless the righteous. Ephesians 5:1. And it says here, amen. You there?
Amen.
Be ye therefore followers of God as dear children and walk in love. Don't remember, faith, the just shall live by faith. We walk by faith. But guess what? Faith worketh by love. And walk in love as Christ also hath loved us and hath given him for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling Savior. So your love for the brethren, it smells sweet to God. Do you know when you do good works, if God smells it? Amen. When you show love, when you concern, you give that. It's a sweet smelling savor.
All right.
To God. Amen. Now, let's close in Revelation because there's so much more I want to say, but time is getting away. Let's go to Revelation and we're going to close here. But now, again, when Jesus gave that warning, he gave it so that his people would never ever lose sight of why he came to die on the cross, because we couldn't save ourselves, could we?
No.
Revelation 21, I saw a new heaven and a new earth.
Yes.
For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away. And there was no more sea. And I, John, I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride for a husband. Our groom is waiting for us.
Hallelujah.
He's going to rapture us up. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is within, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. And God himself shall be with them and be their God. So there's no turning back. Because if you turn back, you're going to miss the rapture.
Yeah.
You turn back, you go, listen. And people say, well, I'm born again. I messed up. Yes, but just repent. Mm-hmm. Amen. Because you don't want to miss. You don't want to remember the church. There was 5 wise and 5 foolish, and half the church was left. So don't assume that you can't backslide out of the will of God and be lost. Amen? Because they were all clean. They were 10 virgins, but they didn't all have oil in them. Look what he says here. Hallelujah. Somebody shout glory.
Glory.
Shout glory again.
Glory.
And God, look what it said. They shall be my people. They shall be my people. God wants you to know you belong. Put your hand on your heart and say, I belong to God.
I belong to God.
Amen. And God belongs to you. God himself shall be there with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. And there shall be no more what?
Death. Death.
Hallelujah.
Neither shall.
Hallelujah. Play a light worship song. Hallelujah. I love this part because I really believe that there's going to be crying in heaven. Not the kind of crying where it says gnashing of teeth.
Yeah.
But this kind of crying. Let's look at this kind of crying. And God shall wipe away all tears.
Yes.
Why are we crying in heaven with the glory and the honor? I believe because God's going to show us how great.
Yes, Lord.
All the trials, all the tests you've been through, all the strain, the disappointment, folks lying on you, stealing money, treating you, mistreating you, relationships that broke your heart, things that you put energy and time and fell apart. We got a lot to deal with. So there's going to be tears. And I believe that the Lord is going to comfort us.
Hallelujah.
I lost my son, Jamal. You know, in Swahili, his name means life.
Yes.
He was 27 years old. I wish he was going to be here.
Yes.
But he went home in 1998.
Yes.
The last century. I'm going to see him.
Yes.
Mama. And Bill died. Bill died October 3rd. And Mama died October 20th. How can I lose a husband and a mama?
Yes.
2.5 weeks. What kind of, you know, what kind of God can keep me from falling, keep me from losing my mind? Lost my ability to walk for 4 years in a wheelchair. 5 years, yeah. Well, the walker helped me in the fifth year. What have you been through? Think about it. The hurt, the pain, the trials, the test. Your precious wife, Deacon Barnes, and you were faithful. You kept your vow in sickness and in health. You took care of your baby, Daphne. I was there. I was an eyewitness. How many of us have been broken and wounded? So when we get to heaven, he gonna look what Jesus said he gonna do. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death.
No more death. Hallelujah.
Don't turn around. He might have been through something, but he gonna wipe away the tears. He bottles up every tear. Hallelujah. He bottles up every tear, every tear. Every time your heart was broken, only God can heal the broken heart. My heart was broken so many times that he just pieces it back together. I said, God, if you have to paste it back together, if you gotta glue it back together, put it back together. And he did. He did. Heartaches, grief, with the pandemic. So many have lost one for many families. One family, they lost 8 people last year. And God, Hosha, Reba, Risoda, Brima, Nano Boshiare, Kiare, Sibanda la Bosha, Yelibianda, Lolohova, Hamdelia. But he puts his arms around us. And he shows us in love. I know, baby. I know you miss your mama. I know you miss Jamal. He with me riding elephants in paradise. Amen. I know you miss Bill. But Bill is welcoming the people. And he showed me my husband, my late husband, in heaven, welcoming people into heaven. He's worthy. Don't turn around. Keep loving, keep forgiving, keep giving. He's going to wipe away every tear. And look what he said, there's no more death. And he takes us to heaven. Neither sorrow, nor crying. No more crying. Those are the last tears you're ever going to cry. The ones that he's going to wipe away, that's the last tears that you ever going to cry. Neither shall there be any more pain. No more gabapentin, no more bare aspens. You have to worry about your arthritis medicine, your rheumatism, none of that. For the former things are passed away. And he said, he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true. They're true and faithful. And he said unto me, it is done. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. And he that overcometh shall inherit all things. And I will be his God. And he shall be my son. First John 5 and 7, 4 said, blessed is he that overcometh. Because when you overcome, that means you got through everything that you had to face on this earth. For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. This is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. And who is he that overcometh the world? But he that believes that Jesus is the Son of God. No turning back. No turning back. So Almighty and Eternal God, we bow our heads before you. We face death, car accidents, some bankruptcies, betrayals, divorce, sickness. So no matter what we walk through, Lord our shepherd, you walk through the valley of the shadow of death with us, and we fear no evil.
Yes, Lord.
And we overcome. This is the victory that overcomes. He that believes that Jesus is the Son of God. Thank you, Lord. For there is no turning, no turning, no turning. Somebody say no turning.
No turning back.
Come on, say it loud. No turning.
No turning.
No turning back. Hallelujah. To God be the glory. Come on and clap your hands. Give God praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, yeah, 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 yeah. No turning back. No, 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 no. Until we meet again, the joy of the Lord is our strength. Be blessed. Hope to see you on next week. Pray with us. 33 years we're celebrating. God bless.